I love those lyrics of that song, Here Comes Heaven. In a very real sense, heaven and earth meet at Christmas, where the Messiah comes to earth. Let's open another box this morning. I've enjoyed doing this. I hope that you've enjoyed playing with me. But let's see what we have this morning. Nice red bows. And let's see what we can find in this box. Ah. Well, this is an interesting combination of things here. Let's see. This is a possum. This possum sits on my desk. If you come to my office, you will have to greet the possum because he sits there and he looks at you the whole time, does he not? There's somebody shaking their head over there. This possum, I don't know if you remember, right before the preschool opened up down there, we had a possum get loose in the building. And Art and I got him cornered in one room back there and shut the door. And it took us probably about 10 days before we finally got that possum to come out from its hiding place to eat some high-quality cat food. But we trapped him, got him out of the building. And the preschool, when they opened, the very first day that they opened, they called me down there, and the board of directors were there, and all the children were there, and they presented me with this possum. It brings great joy in my life, this possum does. As a matter of fact, not too long after that, it was sitting on my desk, and there were two or three children playing in the playground. There was a tall girl, and it looks like a younger brother and a younger sister, and they couldn't see me because the screens for my computer were there, but they were up against the door, and they were looking in my office like this. And the little girl said, "Oh my God, there's a rat in there." That's what she saw. A giant rat. And I opened the door real quick and said, "Are you talking about me?" I haven't seen those three children since. The last I saw, they were running back through there. But it does remind me of the joy that I have because there are some children in our building down there that I'm just enjoying their presence down there. Let's see what else is in here. Well, this. That's supposed to be a bigger shopping bag, but this is the only one I could find. But I enjoy going shopping. Now, I know a lot of men do not like shopping, but I enjoy. I find great joy in going out and being around people that I don't know. I enjoy the crowd. I enjoy watching people, what they're buying. It gives me hints on what I should be buying for Christmas. I like to go out on Christmas Eve. I enjoy more than anything else going shopping on Christmas Eve. I like to go out there. That's really funny because you'll see some men with the deer in the headlights look, you know, that, oh my gosh, I got to get something. And I just found out on Christmas Eve it's easy because you don't have to make any choices. You just take what's left and bring it home, and that becomes. But I enjoy shopping. Let's see what else is in here. If you know me, I enjoy toys. I have a collection of toys like this that I box up, and every year at Christmas time, I pull them out, and I put them around my stairs. This one is singing Ice, Ice Baby, and the shirt says Naughty and Ice. Somebody here gave me this one. I'm not sure who, but I enjoy these kind of toys. I'm the guy that the clerk does not like that comes in the store and goes from toy to toy and turns them all on at one time. I just love to watch them, and I love to play with them. And I enjoy playing with those with my grandchildren. And when they come over, they'll say, "Make that one work." And I get to lay down on the floor and just turn them on and watch them play. I enjoy my grandchildren. I enjoy my children. I also enjoy snow. This snowman reminds me of the snow. And I love it when it snows. I enjoy it more than anything else. But this particular snow woman reminds me of my daughter. Can you hear it? Santa baby. I went to a school program one time and my daughter was going to be singing a solo, and they introduced the solo by saying, "This is the daughter of the Reverend Dr. W. Stephen Brown, the pastor at the First Baptist Church of Walterboro, South Carolina. And my daughter came out in a slinky dress and sang Santa Baby. And I enjoyed every bit of it. I laughed. I thought that was the funniest thing I had ever seen in my life. And so this, it reminds me of snow, but it reminds me of the enjoyment I've had. That is some kind of hip action, wouldn't you think? Yeah. But I enjoy my children. I enjoy Courtney. You want to hear what? Yeah. Next Sunday, we will do Santa Baby as part of our call to worship. I like trains. And one part of being trained is I like pocket watches. And at one time, I used to wear a pocket watch an awful lot when I'd wear a vest. And when Jan and I got married, she gave me this as our wedding gift. And it's a train watch that I keep in my special place where I keep things that are very unique and special to me. It tells me about a life that I have enjoyed with my wife. It's been a great experience from beginning to end, from the moment I met Jan to the moment of this service. I find great joy in her. I enjoy being with her. I enjoy going shopping with her. I enjoy eating with her. I enjoy going out to restaurants with her. I enjoy dancing with her. I just enjoy her presence, and I rejoice that she's a part of my life. That'll be the first and last time that you hear all of that in one place. There's one more here. It's a Christmas card. The Christmas card says, "Play the video."
Huh?
word did you hear? What word did you hear me say over and over and over again? Enjoyed. Joy. Jesus was coming into the world, but before that, some prophecies were made, and one of them was made to a man named Zacharias, who was going to be the father of John the Baptist. In Luke chapter 1, verse 14, it says, "You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth." There are a lot of words in the Old Testament that tell you about happiness. There's not really one that really just jumps out and says rejoice or joy. It's the things that make you happy. Kimkel is a Hebrew word, and it will have it has the connotation of what makes you happy. I mentioned a lot of things that I enjoy, and those things, because I enjoy them, make me happy. But in the New Testament, it becomes a word called chara in the Greek. And chara is always used in reference to something that's difficult, but while it's difficult, they find great joy in it. For example, Paul will often write from prison, "I rejoice in the Lord, I chara, I have joy in the Lord." He'll often tell other people, although he's about to be offered as a sacrifice, that he has great joy, that he considers it a joy to die in the faith, or to die for the faith. So this idea of joy oftentimes comes to us as only things that make us happy. And that's a little bit of a misnomer, because joy and happiness is something that you choose. We came in this morning and everything that could have been out of place or not working was happening in here. The chairs were still kind of scattered from an event we had not been placed back in. I couldn't find the candle lighter to light the candles this morning. The computers did crazy things this morning. The planning center that we normally use to get things ready for Sunday wasn't up and running. And Josh said, "It says it's down everywhere." And we were just all kind of going, choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo. And there was a part of me that just said, whew. You know what I mean? Have you ever been to that part? And then as we began to sing and as we began to hear the words, I began to have great joy. In the midst of our confusion, in the midst of our not-so-funness, in the midst of a struggle, there comes this sense of great joy. I like this guy. I love this video. I found it and said, this has got to be on this particular day. It symbolizes everything that I want to say to you this morning about joy. And I'm not being very creative this morning. I'm not really being deep theological. I think I'm just going to use a very simple acrostic for joy this morning to remind us of a simple truth. There has to be something that motivates our joy. I like the guy when he gets up out of bed and he looks at all of his awards, because in his glory day, he was athletic. He probably ran races. He probably lifted weights. He may have played football. He may have played baseball. But in the back of his mind, he remembered a day when he could. Most of you men here can remember a day when you could. Am I right? You remember when you used to be able to do things that now are not so easy to do. I can remember a day when I could throw a baseball from left field and make it home, and that was not a problem. I can almost make it from here to Jan now. It's a struggle to get that far. I can remember a day when I used to be able to hit a ball and get to first base, and because of my speed, could turn that into a double. I was Danzy Swanson before he ever was born. That's who I was. You baseball fans are looking at me with weird eyes. I had the hair, too. I really did. What am I doing right now? I'm remembering my glory days. Have you ever tried to go back to your glory days like this guy did? I mean, I went to the physical therapist this Friday, and she made me do squats. Now, this is a young girl that's in her late 20s. She played soccer with Callie and Caitlin O'Connor. I've really got to enjoy her, and there was not one part of me that was going to go down and not be able to get back up, because I wasn't going to let that young girl think that I couldn't do it. So she said, I want you to do two sets of 12. And I remember when two sets of 12 were nothing. And I put that bar across my neck, and I kind of flexed a little bit. And there I went, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Just took a short break, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And I said, got him. Is that all you need from me? But Saturday morning, I couldn't move. My legs hurt so bad. And then Jan said, let's go shopping. And so we walked, and last night, my legs hurt so bad. I remember when I could, but now I'm not so good at what I used to be able to do. But don't you like that when you see the picture appear on the table and you know that he's doing something for a specific reason? The motion of going down and picking up and stretching it out. And you know that he's going back to his glory days and he's being motivated by something. It's his granddaughter. I bought the star for the top of the tree, and I am not going to let my joy be robbed of me. I'm going to pick her up and hold her so she can put that star on the top of the tree. That brought great joy to him, great joy to the granddaughter, great joy to the daughter who's watching from a distance. Here's what I'm saying to you. Joy, the acrostic, is pretty simple. When the Bible says you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at the birth. Many will rejoice at his birth. And that the fact that the angels begin to say something to him, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill towards men. Good news has come. When the angel begins to appear to them and says, do not be frightened, for I'm bringing you a great joy. I'm bringing you a wonderful story that's going to start unfolding. Joy for me begins with where I put my motivation. If I put my motivation in that which I can do myself, I'm often a failure. If I put my joy in what other people do, I may falter and fail there. If my dependency upon other people to do for me or my other people to give me something that I want or even to respond to me the way I want, I'm often disappointed because sometimes those things don't measure up. But my joy has never faltered when I begin with Jesus. My joy has never slacked because in there I find three truths that bring me great joy. First and foremost, the truth that the Messiah has come. I like that. That brings joy to me. I feel like the story has now a second part. It is not just something that I'm waiting on, but it's something that has been fulfilled. The Messiah has come. I take great delight in sharing with my Jewish friends, you gave me the best gift that I ever got in my life. You have given me the Messiah, and if I can just return that gift to you, you'll just not know how much joy it would bring. Jewish people don't know how to do that. They don't know how to accept the fact that I believe that Messiah came out of Jerusalem, came out of Judea, came out of Judaism, that the greatest gift that I've got is that the Messiah has come. The promised Messiah, the scriptures that I hold dear to me says that one day a child will be born and that child will reign and that child, there will be no ending of his reign. He will be the Messiah. And I find great joy in that. I love the Christmas story about how heaven becomes a part of earth, how the light shines into the world. Did you see the guy that fell off the cruise ship last week? Have you seen that news story? Fell off a cruise ship. He didn't know how he fell off the cruise ship. He said he had had a few drinks. You know, if you fall off a cruise ship and don't know you've done it, you've had more than a few drinks. Yeah, and pretty obviously he had had probably more than a few drinks. He said he woke up and he was in the water. And I'm thinking, okay. And he said, there was nothing. It was nighttime, and I was in the water, and I could see nothing this way, nothing this way, nothing this way, nothing this way, and I realized I had fallen off the ship. This guy was brilliant. And for something like 15 hours, are you catching this? 15 hours he treaded water in an ocean. As he said, nothing above me, nothing below me, nothing around me. I saw a light, but it was way off. I started swimming towards the light. And the closer I get to the light, the further it would go away from me. He couldn't catch the cruise ship. Can you think about that moment? He said there was something that kept bumping him in the leg. And so he kicked it and it ran away. Yeah, right. He just didn't taste good that first nibble. 15 hours. And then he said he heard a helicopter. And the helicopter had a spotlight and it was going round and round and around. And he said, I was waving with everything that I could do. And then the light shone on me. Can you paint that picture in your own mind for a moment? Darkness below, darkness above, darkness in any direction that you go. You're bobbing in the water. You've been there. You're exhausted. You're tired. You're not happy. And you see the light. But then it shone on me. And he said, I rejoiced. Wow. That's it. I don't know if you catch that or not, but that's the story of Christmas. Here we are in our dark world where everything seems to go wrong, and we let those kind of things rob us of our joy, and we forget that the greatest light of eternity has shone on us. Has found us in our darkness, has found us in our sorrow, has found us in our depression, has found us in our grief. No matter what it is that causes us to feel unhappy, all of a sudden we realize that that light shines into the world and it shines on me. It makes me happy. I want to rejoice that I have been found. I start with Jesus. Not only is he the Messiah, but he also is the one who came to save. Came to rescue. Can you imagine just for a moment what it must have felt like for that guy when they started lowering down the thing that they were going to get on, and it was going to lift him back up into that helicopter? Can you imagine the experience? Jan and I went on a cruise several years ago, and as a result of that, a man jumped overboard. In the midnight hour, we felt the ship turning around. It took him about an hour to get all the way back to where he was. And they put the light on him. They shone the light on him. And they took a rescue ship, a boat out there to get him. And they literally had to hit the guy in the face, knock him out, because he didn't want to get in the boat. Next morning, I asked the cruise director, and I said, was there a shipwreck last night? Were there some fishermen that were? No, she said, he jumped overboard. Tried to kill himself, but he didn't do a very good job. And I'm thinking, she's angry. We're putting him ashore today. He's banned from getting on ships and blah, 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 blah. She said, we even had to bust him in the nose to get him in the rescue ship to get him in. He did not want to be rescued. But he sure did bob in the water a long time, didn't he? Do you realize that there's a lot of folks that when the light shines, they go, not now. I don't want to be seen. Don't shine on me. And it's hard to believe. Jesus said it this way. The light has come into the world. The light shines into the darkness. But men loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. I want to be saved. I want to be redeemed. I want to know that I don't live my life in darkness. The Messiah has come. That's first and foremost the greatest story. Second of all, he came to save. And third of all, he came for all people. That when we think about our joy, we have to realize that our joy is not limited to only a few. Wouldn't it have been strange if Jesus only came to the Jews? That leaves all of you out except Josh. Josh is the only one to be redeemed because he is Jewish. As Josh says, Jew-ish. Do you understand that? What if Jesus only came for white people? What if Jesus only came for men, left the women out? What if Jesus only came for a certain age grouping of people, and at a certain age he says, don't qualify anymore? What happens if Jesus came for only one part of the earth? Let's say everybody that lives inside the boundaries of the United States of America. What if Jesus only came into the world and said, I'm not going to mess with anybody outside the Middle East? It's not qualified like that. For God so loved the world, there's great joy in that I get to be included, you get to be included, and everybody around us gets to be included. You know, my life changed a lot when I began to look at people and say, that's somebody Jesus died for. You look at somebody and you have a negative response to them for some reason. You don't like them. They're outside the norm for you. There's something that you... But if you start with Jesus and you say, Jesus is my Messiah who came to save and came to save all, therefore the conclusion is that's somebody that Jesus died for. And all of a sudden there's great joy. Let's begin with Jesus. Jay. But there's something about the others. There's this O. And great joy is beginning to realize that others are important. That others are those that we are willing to sacrifice for in order for their well-being to be reached. Others means that I follow the example of Jesus and see others as greater than myself. Can you imagine this Messiah that we're talking about, this King of Kings, this Savior of the world, taking off or putting on an apron around his waist, picking up a basin of water, and kneeling at the feet of his disciples to wash their feet? Does that not sound weird to you? King of Kings, Savior of the world, Son of God, Messiah, who saw the feet of his disciples as more important. And then he turns around and says to them, now I want you to go do like this. I want you to go do like this. Use this as your pattern. See yourself in a humble role, but see what you do on behalf of others as important. I believe that we find our self-worth not in what we're able to gain for ourselves, but rather in what we do for others. I mean, let's just look at this Jesus guy. If he's going to be the beginning of our joy, how did he exercise joy? By suffering, by going against the norm, by not being swept away by the status quo, but rather said, I came into the world to seek and to save those who were lost. That means the prostitute that's out on the street. That means the drug addict. That means the homeless guy. That means the race that's different than yours. It means across party lines. It means it goes across border lines and country lines. That it doesn't really matter. I came that all of them might be saved. And here's how I will demonstrate that. I will carry a cross up Calvary's Hill, and I will die on a cross to demonstrate my love, God's love, for the other. I love that hymn that we used to sing, even though I don't like the hymn. It's one of those that I keep reminded of that says he could have called 10,000 angels. Can you understand that? There's a part of me that wants him to become a ninja hero. You know, in our modern day terminology, I want Jesus to come down off the cross and whip people. I want him to kick Romans. I want him to destroy. I want him to have the Calvary come running in out of nowhere and sweep him down off the cross, because that's how we have been taught heroism. We never teach heroism as the person who's sacrificing on behalf of the other. And folks, we're being saturated with that today. Where it's not the other that's important, but it's only that I get my way. And it doesn't really matter how it impacts anyone else. Not Jesus. Jesus said, you ask me how much I love you, and he spread out his arms on Calvary's cross and said, I love you this much. The other has to become important. I like doing things for other people. It's one of the greatest parts of my joy. Jesus first, others second. Who's why? Yourself. There's a part of me that has to realize that God created me just the way I am. That God wired me the way that I am. God allowed me to grow up in a certain environment so that I could be the Steve Brown that I am today. And we all sometimes struggle with that. Why did God make me like this? Because you're unique and special just the way you are. That God created you and made no mistakes when he did so. And oftentimes we look at ourselves and we see the faultiness inside of us, and all of a sudden our joy is swept away because we no longer see the value of who we are, but we compare ourselves to everyone else and say, why am I not like him? Or why am I not like her? Or why am I not successful like that person? Or why do I have cancer when everybody else doesn't? Why is it that I struggle with this in my life? And why is it that I struggle with this in my life? And all of a sudden, the joy is taken away. Paul looked at himself and I said, I am a new creature. I am no longer Paul, but it's Christ who lives in me. And my value and my worth is as he reveals himself in and through me to others. So sometimes we just have to look in the mirror and say, you know what? God did a pretty good job on me. I like me just the way I am. Some of the most miserable times in my life is when I wanted to be somebody else. Some of the most miserable times in my life is when I would look in the mirror and wish that I wasn't me, but that I could be someone else, anyone else. Do you realize that Jesus looked at people and said, she's okay just the way she is. I love her just that way. I love him that way. A blind Bartimaeus, a Zacchaeus in a tree, a man with leprosy, a woman caught in the very act of adultery. On and on it goes. Never once did Jesus say to them, I'm going to change you to be like me. He always said to them, I created you the way you are. How'd you like to be that blind guy? And when Jesus explained to his disciples he was born this way, for this very moment. Listen to what I just said. Whose sin? This man, his mom and dad, grandparents, whose sin that made this man blind? And what did Jesus say? He was born this way for this very moment. You were born this way for these moments that God gives you. And you're okay just the way you are. Now, does that mean that I should take great joy in being a bad person? No, it's not what I'm saying. Most of us do things in our lives because we don't like who we are, and we have a hard time accepting who we are. But when we look in the mirror and realize that maybe God has created something here that's got some value to it. And I find my value, folks, in giving to others. I find my value in being able to serve and to give. That's not bragging and it's not trying to highlight. I just find great joy in doing things for other people. I find my joy and my skill and my ability in being able to help others maybe find their place. Do you understand what I'm saying here? Joy is not something that we just wake up one morning and say, I'm going to be happy today whether I like it or not. I'm going to get in the Christmas spirit today, so I'm going to play Christmas songs until it hits me. No, joy begins very purposeful. It begins in my life when I realize the Messiah has come. I'm not celebrating the birth of Jesus for the very first time. I've told this story year after year after year after year. I believe it to be true. The Messiah has come. And I find joy in that. He chooses to save all. I find great joy in that. And on those all, he didn't leave me out. I find great joy in that. So what should I do? Be satisfied with who I am and reach out to others in some way. I love this old guy that picks up his granddaughter. He doesn't make a big deal out of it. Did you see the nosy neighbor? Do you have a nosy neighbor like that? She did everything she could to belittle him, didn't she? Made faces at him, laughed at him. Even so much so that when his daughter came and he was lifting up that weight, he covered it up very quickly because he didn't want her to know what was going on. The joy wasn't in that he stood up and said, "Y'all look at me. Watch what I'm going to do." The joy was in himself when he realized, "I can do this. I can sacrifice." Did you notice the clock in the video? What time did it start? What time did he get up the very first time to go out into his shed and lift up that weight? The first time was what? The first time was 7 o'clock. The next time was 10 o'clock. The next time was 11 o'clock. Do you know what that said to me? He was hurting. It's saying to me he was sacrificing. That wasn't just an easy struggle for him, but that he insisted he was going to work through the pain, work through the sacrifice, because he had a goal in mind. He was going to lift his granddaughter to put that star on top of the tree. He was whipped. He was spit upon. His beard was plucked out. Crown of thorns were placed on his head. They made fun of. They ridiculed. They stripped him naked and marched him up a tree, marched him up a hill, carrying the crossbeam of a tree. There they drove nails in his hands and left him there to die. He suffered. But what great joy. What does he say? "It is finished. I have accomplished my goal. I have reached my purpose. The reason that I'm here is this cross, and it is finished. Into your hands I commend my spirit. If anything else happens, God, it's now in your hands because I've accomplished. I have great joy even in the midst of my pain. I have great joy because I have finished what you have called me to do." In the midst of your pain, do you find room for great joy? Dear Father, we pray that you'd remind us today that we who are human are not perfect. That many times our imperfection causes us sorrow, grief, pain. We find ourselves struggling. We find ourselves being angry all the time. We find ourselves being pushed to the side. And for some of us, joy just doesn't come all that often. Oh God, send some children into our lives. Send somebody with great need into our lives. Send some people into our lives so that we might know you and once again be restored to joy. For we pray it in Christ's name, for his sake.